going to stay. Well, I was going to welcome all of you. I'm not sure I really feel like all of you. No, I'm kidding. It's good to be in the Lord's house, isn't it? Good to be able to smile and to laugh and to enjoy one another's company and to enjoy God's presence. That's what we shoot for when we come here. If God's not here, really, we've come for nothing. So we want to be in his presence and worship him today. Let's pray together as we begin. Dale Bailey, lead our opening prayer, please.
Y'all stay standing this morning.
Come into my heart. Be my Savior. I want to go to heaven with you when I die. You need to do that if you haven't done that. I said you need to do that. Well, we've been preaching this series of messages about worship. And this is still the first sermon in the series. This is the third week we've been on it. And that's my fault because I chase rabbits. And I've never caught one yet, but I've shot a few of them, all right? But anyway, I'm going to close out this section, the Lord willing, today. And it has to do with misconceptions that we have about worship. And so many people have so many different ideas and ideals about how worship is supposed to be conducted, what it is supposed to consist of, how we are to act in worship, and it is a source of contention and a source of division among a lot of different people. I haven't been to many churches of different denominations except for funerals because I work at a funeral home, son. And I don't think you get the full gist of it at a funeral, but I'm telling you, there are people who do things differently than the way we do it. And those of us who've lived, let's say, more than 60 years, did I get an amen anywhere? We have a tendency to get set in our ways. Can I get an amen? If you wives want to talk amen about your husbands, go ahead and do it. This would be a good time to do it. But we're that way. I told this a week or so ago. I mentioned when I was younger, and I explained this in our Wednesday night Bible study, but I remember asking my dad when I was younger, I said, Dad, why don't we lift holy hands? He said, because our hands ain't holy. I said, okay, I got dirty hands. I'm always going to have unholy hands. But when my dad grew older, he softened up a little bit. And he told me about his experience every night. He would go out into the utility room off of their carport. That was his smoking room and his prayer room. He was a Baptist, all right? He never kicked that habit, okay? But anyway, he would go out there and he would spend hours praying to God. I don't ever remember my dad praying that many hours when I was growing up. I knew he prayed for us. Sometimes he prayed over us, but Dad got up at 3:00 in the morning to go to work. The only people I knew that did that were bread men and people who milk cows. But anyway, Dad was a bread man. He got up and went left early and did get home till about dark. And we had a very brief window where we visited. Mom always cooked a good meal. You can tell that by looking at me. And I still got a wife that cooks good meals. You can still tell it by looking at me. But anyway, we didn't have that much family worship time together. But after Dad retired and after Dad got grandchildren, after we grew up and made him lose all of his hair, he would go out and he would spend sometimes hours praying for his family and praying for his church. And he told me a secret. He said when he prayed out there, he lifted his hands. You know, I guess his hands got holy. I don't know. I'm being facetious on that. But we have differences in the way we do things. Worship was first mentioned in Genesis 22 when Abraham, when God told him to go sacrifice his son Isaac on the altar. And that's such a good story. We haven't taken time to preach it in this series. But when God sent him, it's the first time he responded affirmatively, immediately, obeyed God right now. And he got Isaac, he got his servants, he got the donkey, he got the wood, he got the fire. They headed up toward the mountain where God told him to go. When they got to the foot of the mountain, he left his servants there. And he told them, he said, my son and I are going to go up there and worship, and we're going to come back to you. Now listen, God had told Abraham to sacrifice his son, and Abraham was going to do it. It was the first time he believed God enough that this was the chosen one. He believed God enough that if he killed his son, he said, me and him both are coming down. At that point, Abraham believed in the resurrection, in the resurrecting power of God. He said, we're going to go worship, but we're coming back down. Going to church and worship are not the same thing. And I'll tell you how I know that. I have worshiped. worshiped when I wasn't in church, and that's one of my points of my sermon today, so I won't delve into this very much, but I have also worshiped in church, and I have been in church meetings and church services where I didn't worship at all because I didn't feel the presence and the power of God. Well, let me go over these misconceptions that we've thrown out over the course of the last few weeks, and I won't preach them all again, because if I do, I won't get to the last two, and that's what I want to preach about today. The first one has to do with the person of worship. And so often people think that when we worship, it's when we get together and we just talk about God. Well, we can talk about God anytime, any place, anywhere, and we can worship God anytime, any place, anywhere. But talking about and worshiping God are not the same thing. Worship is when we encounter God. Worship is when we meet God. Worship is when we come into His presence, when God is there, and we know it because we feel Him and we experience Him. You've been there? You've done that? If you haven't, you need to, and maybe you haven't because you don't know Him personally. But I'm telling you, I have been in the presence of God. I felt His Spirit in my life, in my heart. I felt Him surround me in those times. Worship, that's what worship is all about. That's why I say, when we come here, we come because we want God to meet us in this place. The second one has to do with the preferences of worship, and that is that worship must be done in a certain style, and the truth of the matter is the way we worship and our style of worship is a matter of preference. It's a matter of what we like. It's a matter of what we're comfortable with, how we grew up and what we do. The third has to do with the purpose of worship, and so many people think that the purpose of worship is for you and I to be pleased. And a lot of times, the weight of that falls on the preacher because people say, well, I'm going to church. I hope he preaches a good sermon today. I don't know if I've ever preached a good sermon in my life, but let me tell you, if I've pointed you to God and you've seen God and experienced God, worship happens when God is pleased. Not us, but God is pleased. The participants of worship is the next one. Worship is a spectator activity. That's because, for the most part, we sit and we watch and we listen. But if we don't see with our spiritual eyes, and we don't experience Him in our feelings, and it's not all about feeling, but feelings are involved. That's the last point I'm going to preach about today. Worship is an experience in which I am involved. Number five. It has to do with pursuit of worship. Worship happens if I'm gratified. If what I like happens. Worship happens when God is glorified. It makes a difference whether I experience what I like, what I feel, what I want or not. If God's glorified, that's what matters. Well, today I want to read from John chapter 4. Thank you, Brother Clark, for the music. I really appreciate Brother Clark singing that last song. I requested it. And if you know your Bible, you know that that's a story taking from John chapter 4. Let me just give you the backdrop. I don't want to read all these verses. It's verses 4 through 26. So Joel's going to throw them up on the screen as we go along. I have read this passage probably 8 or 10 times this week. And I've read it a lot of times. It's a very familiar passage of Scripture to most of you in the Bible. It's when Jesus met the woman at the well. Remember that story? Well, as I read it this week, new light was shed. I didn't get any new revelation from God. Don't think I've gone bad or anything, all right? But I saw it in a different light and in a different way than I'd ever seen it before. As I imagined the conversation between Jesus and this woman. And it starts out, he'd been arguing with the Pharisees, and they were after him all the time, about how many people he had baptized. And he didn't put much stock in baptizing people. He said he'd baptize a few, but not many. So it says in verse 4, I must needs go through Samaria. We don't grasp that for two reasons. Number one, we don't talk that way. But he's talking to his disciples there with him. And he says to them, look, we've got to go through Samaria. And I imagine in their minds they push back. It doesn't give us that in the narrative, but you see it as the truth unfolds in the story. The Jews hated the Samaritans. And the Samaritans despised and hated the So much so that the Jews, listen, if you were up in Judea, which is north, and you wanted to go to Galilee, which is down in the south, the straightest route would be to go right straight through Samaria. But Jews wouldn't go through Samaria. They would cross over the River Jordan on the east side and go through what we call Perea. And it's where those 2.5 tribes settled on the east side of the River Jordan. The tribe of Reuben, Gad, and half the tribe of Manasseh, I believe. And so they were still in Judea. They weren't in Samaria. So Jesus told them, I've got to go there. I have to go there. I must need. He was constrained. He was compelled to go to Samaria. People ask why. Well, it's very obvious why. He had an appointment with this woman at the well. She didn't know it, but he knew it. The disciples didn't know it, but he knew it. And that's why I said to you this morning, if you're here and you've never been saved, you have an appointment of divine destiny. God orchestrated it. He's met you in this place today. Don't slough off this opportunity. So they go. Departed, went through Samaria, came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, where Jacob's well was. Now, Jesus was weary and he was thirsty, and he had sent the disciples into town to go buy Chick-fil-A. Well, they went to buy food. Something was there, all right. If they were really spiritual, it would have been Chick-fil-A and not McDonald's, so that's why I said that. But anyway. So Jesus went and he sat down at this well. And this woman comes and it's high noon. Well, women drew the water. I said women drew the water. None of you men had the guts to say amen, all right? We could have paraphrased that and drawn it down to other chores, okay? But they did. That was their job. But they never drew the water at high noon. They either came early in the morning when it was cool, or they came late in the afternoon when it was cool. But this woman came at high noon. And she came alone. Usually they would gather there like in sewing clubs and in women's missionary auxiliaries, and they would draw the water and put them into their pots or their skins, whatever they care. And they would talk, they would do that. And it was part of their fellowship time of that. But she came alone. And there was a reason she came alone. She came alone because she had a past. She came alone because she was an outcast. She came alone because she was despised by those in the city where she came from, probably Sychar. And if you know her past, when she and Jesus encountered one another and they began to talk, Jesus asked her to go get her husband. And she said, I don't have a husband. And Jesus said to her, I know. He didn't say, I know, but I did. He said, you've had 4 or 5. He said, you've had that many and you're living with somebody that you're not married to now. And she said, whoa, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Yeah, I guess so. And people say, why was Jesus so hard on her? Why did he make it difficult on her? Listen to me. This ain't about worship. This is about salvation. You can't get saved until you see yourself as God sees you. You may say, as most people do, I ain't that bad, preacher. Yes, you are. You may say, well, I've not done what he's done, or I'm not who she is, but we are, because the Bible says we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That means we don't measure up. And listen, he already knows. He knew about her. That's why he wanted to meet her there. And if you know the rest of the story, and we're going to read some of it in just a moment, but if you know the rest of the story, Jesus knew that she was going to be the one. After she got saved, after she drank of that spiritual water, the Bible says that she went back to town and she told everybody in that town. She came out. She wasn't hiding from them anymore. She said, you got to come meet this guy. He told me everything I ever did. Well, they already knew what she did. And she knew what she did. But God knew what she did. And now she didn't care and God didn't care. Whew, that's good stuff right there. Hadn't got to my sermon yet. Where am I, Brother Joel, on verses?
when she said that, she said, "Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet." Now she wants to talk about religion. It amazes me how often people who are not saved want to talk about religion. I just want to tell you today, religion ain't ever saved nobody. And I know I just butchered the English language, and I don't care. Religion does not save us. And so many people who are religious, the most religious people in Jesus' day are the ones that wanted him crucified. He didn't do it their way. So she wanted to talk religion. "I perceive that thou art a prophet." She said, "Sir, our fathers worship in this mountain." That would probably be Mount Gerizim, which is in Samaria. And they had their own style, their own form of worship. Remember, they were half Jew. They were half Gentiles. And he said, "Y'all worship in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her in verse 21, "Woman," I like that, "woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither worship in this mountain nor in Jerusalem. Worship the Father." He said, "You worship you know not what. We know what we worship because salvation is of the Jews." That almost sounds haughty for Jesus to say that. A better translation, listen, salvation is from the Jews. The Savior comes through them. That was a promise to Abraham, and it was fulfilled in Jesus, and it's still good today. Amen. Now watch this. Watch this. Jesus had said when she came to the well, I'm backing up a little bit. He's sitting there, and he said, "Would you draw me some water? Why don't you get it yourself? I don't have anything to draw with." She said, "Why are you talking to me? I'm a Samaritan." And Jesus said, "If you knew who you were talking to and you knew what he could do for you, I can give you a drink of water and you'll never thirst again." Well, she wanted it. She wanted it. So they're talking about worship. And Jesus says in verse 24, "God is a spirit." You ever seen God? I've never seen him. I've seen him with my spiritual eyes. I've experienced his presence. I've experienced him. I know he lives inside me, and sometimes I squelch and quench the spirit. Sometimes I grieve the spirit of God. I know that. We all do. And if you don't think you do, you need to be in the altar when we give it the altar call in a little while, because we do. But he says God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The Father seeks such to worship him. I love the rest of that. The woman said, "I know that the Messiah will come who's called Christ, and when he's come, he'll tell us all things." And Jesus said, "You got it. I am he." Well, I want to talk about the place of worship this morning. with me, okay? When I was about 15 or 16, 15 going on 16, somewhere along in there, I mean, I'd been to church my whole life. I was carried to church inside my mom. That's all I knew was going to church, okay? With church, every time doors were open. And our church had gone through a bad time. There were some people in the church that didn't like the pastor, and they managed to vote him out. And that's a terrible thing when it happens in churches. Some of you know you've been through that. And my dad and our family were really close to our pastor. Well, right after that happened, we got up the next Sunday. I'm thinking we're going to get ready to go to church. We're getting ready to go. We didn't go to church. We went out of town to see some friends. I didn't think nothing about it. That happened every now and then. We might have went back to church one time in the next 3 months. But we never said, I never heard mom and dad say, hey, we're not going back to church anymore. We're just going to quit church. It never was one of those things that we thought through. We discussed as a family. I didn't have much say being 16 years old. I thought I should have, but I didn't, all right? But it just happened. It wasn't planned. I'm saying that to say to you, I've never in almost 50 years of being a preacher met anybody who said, you know, I just got up one day and said, I'm done with church. I'm done with God. I'm done with congregating. I'm done with worship. It's always, every time, it's been a slow fade. They planned it. That's the way it happened. Well, let me tell you why this is dangerous. It will affect you, but it's the next generation who suffers for it. It's your children and your grandchildren. There's a story in the Old Testament. It's in 2 Chronicles 26, and I wasn't going to turn over there, but I changed my mind, all right? I won't read it all. I'll just tell it to you, all right? Uzziah had been a good king. He was the one that Uzziah died when Isaiah went to the temple to worship and saw God. But Uzziah, he became very presumptuous and prideful in his old age. And he decided that he was going to take the place and stand in the place as a priest. And he went into the temple to make an offering to God, and he wasn't supposed to. That wasn't his place. And they ran him out. The priest ran him out. He got mad. And he started a church fight. Well, Uzziah eventually died. Isaiah mourned his death because he was a good king, except for messing up so bad at the end. But listen to this. His son, Jotham, took his place. And it says in verse number 2 of chapter 27 that Jotham would not go to the temple. Hear that? Daddy got into a church fight, temple fight with the priest, and the son said, I ain't going back. You want to know that it gets worse? If you look on over in chapter 28, in verse number 24, Uzziah's grandson is now king. His name was Ahaz. And Ahaz gathered together the vessels of the house of God, cut in pieces the vessels of the house of God, and shut the doors of the house of God. Every time I read that, it gives me chills. That's serious. We've been blessed. Becky and I are studying the history of our church. We're trying to find out who the pastors were. I told you, I was just thrilled me to find out how this church started and how the Lord was working in it. But let me tell you, this church doesn't have to be here, and it may not be here within 30 years. You say, oh, Brother Paul, that'll never happen. Don't be presumptuous. Well, Let me get to this and finish the sermon. about the psychology of worship. A lot of people think that worship is only involved in how I feel, how it makes me feel. But worship involves, it does involve our emotions. I get that. We were sitting there singing those songs. I'm telling you, I'm getting to be an old softy in my old age, and I'm glad. But I sat there and shed tears over listening to you all sing and the words to those songs, knowing that God was in this place. It was an emotional thing. So our emotions are involved in worship. I get that. There's nothing wrong with that. Frankly, I wish we'd be a little bit more emotional sometimes, okay? I get tickled sometimes. I've preached in a lot of churches through the years. I was blessed when I was a younger preacher, preached a lot of revivals. I did it full-time for about 2 years. I think I was in 56 different churches in that 20-some-odd months. So I preached in a lot of places. I'll tell you something. I get on to y'all for maybe not being as demonstrative about saying amen. I'm telling you, I've been places where you couldn't even get a holy grunt out of nobody. All right? I mean, it was dead. I could feel it was dead when I walked into the building. And it's not as bad as one church. We had a preacher preach a revival here for us. He said he was sitting up there by the preacher on the preacher's seat before the church started. And the preacher leaned over and said, "I hate these people." Well, that's great. That's a great way for a pastor to feel. And in a minute, he said, "They hate me too." He said, "I thought," the evangelist said, "I thought about leaving," but he said, "We didn't have a meeting." You can't have a meeting. You can't worship God in that kind of a spirit and in that kind of an atmosphere. So our emotions have to be involved. But we come to church sometimes and we don't feel good. We've had a bad day. We've had a bad week. I'll tell you, I know, especially when we were raising our children, if Satan was going to give us a hassle, it was going to be on Sunday morning. Ever been there? Come on now, testify. And we got up and the devil started to attack. Why? He wants to get us emotionally distraught. Why? Because our emotions are involved in our worship. But it's not just strictly emotional. If all we do in worship is strive to get ourselves to a point where we get emotionally worked up, but we don't experience and bow down in the presence of God, then that's all it was just being worked up. One guy, I love it. I read after him, so I put it in my notes. Every worship service is not going to make you quiver in your liver. So feeling emotional is not what we shoot for. We are in God's presence, and our understanding of who God is broadened. And I have a very limited understanding of God. I've been saved since I was 10 years old. But he said in Isaiah chapter number 55, he said, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, and my ways are not your ways." And so when I experience worship, even though I don't know all I wish I knew about him, and I don't understand him as much as I wish I did, I don't know his ways. I don't know what he's thinking and what he's doing. But it makes me stand in awe of him to worship. Brother Joel, you think our little video is going to work? Okay, I'll step back and close my sermon with this. Amy Bailey Egger sent this to me the other day. I'll tell you who it is. You remember President Ronald Reagan? This is his son, Ron Reagan. This was a commercial that came on Sunday night during 60 Minutes. That's when 60 Minutes comes on, ain't it? I ain't never home on Sunday night when I was up. This was a commercial that was actually played on TV. And I'm giving this to you for a reason. All right, Brother Joel, fire it up and see if she'll go, please.
Hi, I'm Ron Reagan, an unabashed atheist, and I'm alarmed, as you may be, by the intrusions of religion into our secular government. That's why I'm asking you to join the Freedom From Religion Foundation, the nation's largest and most effective association of atheists and agnostics working to keep state and church separate, just like our founders intended. Please, join the Freedom From Religion Foundation today. Ron Reagan, lifelong atheist, not afraid of burning in hell.
There's something he doesn't know, and you may not know. One day, the Bible says that every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You're either going to acknowledge him here, or you're going to acknowledge him in judgment. Bow your heads, please. If you're here this morning, you're not saved, please, God's people, pray for lost people. I believe there are lost people here. I don't know who it is, but I believe there are. Pray for ourselves that we'll find that way individually to see God sitting on his throne when we worship him here in this place. If you need to pray for someone who's sick, pray for someone that's lost, pray for someone who's straying. If you need to just come confess your heart to God, this altar is open, but you respond in this invitation, especially if you're not saved. Holy Father in heaven, Lord, as best we can, we've tried to worship you today, and it's hard in this